first off, I want to thank everybody for coming. I hope that everybody will be able to benefit, and you know, it's meant to be a discussion, so please do ask any questions you have. We'll have Q&A at the end. So, as you can see, the lecture series, which is a two-part series, is titled The Crisis of Capitalism and the Alternative. And so, you know, we often hear stories in the news about, you know, corrupt business practices, a failing economy, and all these sort of social issues that seem to stem from the business world. And so what we want to do here is try to delve into these issues and try to really tackle the problem here. And as you can see, the first part of this lecture series is entitled Disaster Capitalism, or Is Capitalism a Disaster? And the point we're trying to make here is, let's look at our current economy and let's try to determine if we're just having a bad form of our current capital system, or is it possible that maybe this economic system is just, you know, problematic in nature. And so we have our speaker today, Manik Tarthana, forgive me for the pronunciation. He's a CPA with over 10 years of experience in the field of financial audits technology. He graduated from University of Waterloo and worked at Deloitte, where he provided consulting services to large players in the Canadian economy. After obtaining his CA, he taught at the university as an adjunct lecturer, and during that time, he did research that included a paper on examination of the factors that led to the financial bubbles within the capitalist system. He was also an independent consultant for 8 years, and he's currently a senior manager at Deloitte. He has given numerous talks on Islam and economics, including the legal status of Islam, Islam and world poverty, and topics on the financial crisis. And with that said, I'd like to welcome Matt to the stage.
So is volume is good? Alright, so Mr. Rahman Rahim, Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen, Wassalatu Wassalamu Ala Rasulullah, and Assalamu Alaikum Warahmatullahi Wabarakatuh. So I just want to first begin and say,
alright, is that okay? The volume? Alright, so I just want to say, first of all, thanks and Jazakallah Khair to M-Commerce for putting this talk together and you know, setting up this event for us. It's a very important discussion. And also, I just want to thank you for taking time out of your schedules. I know you're all busy. I know you have a lot of other things to do, and so I appreciate you spending this evening with us. So I guess I'm going to return to this question after, is that what are we going to do with this information, right? Because we live in an era where we're just used to being consumers of information. So my hope and my goal is that this presentation, you'll take it in and it'll activate you to do something. I'm not saying you're going to necessarily agree with my point of view, but what I'm hoping is that that this information will become a point of action and it'll activate you, right? I'm not writing any books right now. I'm not on a tour to do that. So, you know, why am I doing this? And, you know, my hope and my goal is that that this will activate you to think and to want that motivation. So I just want to begin in terms of, you know, when you talk about capitalism and you talk about the economic system, it can be challenging because it's something intangible, right? And so sometimes people might think it's an academic discussion, but I hope to show you by the end of my presentation that it's not. And I just want you to think about what led you into this room, and who came to this university, who made those choices, right? It's the economic system that determines who can come and get an education. I just want you to think, if university is free, who would be in this room? And that's what the economic system is about. Think about when you go to class, who's sitting beside you and who's not sitting beside you. So it's the system that determines who we connect with and who we don't connect with. And that's the real effect of the system. And it has a tangible effect, and it affects us all. The other challenges that we have is that how do we get beyond individualism, right? Because individualism is a kind of an idea that we sort of absorb by osmosis as we grow up through this in society. And how do we get into a more societal mode of thinking where we recognize the reality that when we do things, it affects everyone? And that was abundantly clear in the financial crisis, which I will talk about. So the way I've divided my presentation is into three parts. So the first part is basically to discuss, you know, just a level set to give, like, so they're all on the same page in terms of what is capitalism. Then we'll look at, the concept in capitalism is that the focus is of the economy is production. So we'll examine how that affects what we eat, what we drink, and then basically how we live. Then we'll move on to part three, which will look at, the financial crisis and the impact of bankers and banking in that sector and how that affects us. And then we'll conclude on whether it's disaster capitalism or it's capitalism. So first off is the capitalism and the capitalist mindset. So when we talk about capitalism, what do we really mean here? So you have to, the capitalist system was born out of the Enlightenment in Europe. What was going on back then in the Middle Ages was there was a struggle between the intellectuals and the church. Because what was happening is the church had this the geocentric worldview, and then the scientists in that society realized that this contradicted reality, and so there was a clash. And the ultimate resolution of that clash is that you keep religion as a personal matter because the church in Europe didn't know what it was talking about, and then we're free to do whatever we want. And so this is where the idea of freedom comes from. And that idea of freedom was applied in the public sphere in whatever man does, personal freedom, freedom of expression, and the most important freedom, which ended up being, is the freedom of ownership. And that's not me saying that, that's the founding fathers of the United States saying that. This is James Madison, who's one of the founding fathers of America. And what he's saying in there, and you can Google this yourself, is I believe it was the Federalist Paper number 10, when they were discussing the Constitution. What they said was that the purpose of government was to protect the minority of the opulent. So America was born on the idea that those with the capital are the ones that the government should serve and should protect. So this is, a couple centuries before Occupy, somewhere in that figure. But that's where this idea of freedom of ownership, the idea that capitalism was born out of. What is that exactly is a capitalist mindset? So in the sense that, so what becomes the most important thing in our society, and this is a theme that will come up over and over again as I go through the examples, is that the pursuit of profits takes dominance over everything. So what happened was that back in 1999, a jury awarded some victims of car accidents $4.9 billion. What happened was that the bumper in the Malibu was built too close to the gas tank was built too close to the bumper. So in a rear end explosion, a rear end accident resulted in an explosion. And what ended up happening is that six motors were severely burned. And what happened was that if you've seen the movie Fight Club, where they talk about the formula for recall, this is sort of where that comes from. Is the idea is that there was an engineer by the name of Richard Ivey. And what he did was that he did a calculation that approximately, because of this problem, 500 people will die. That'll be $200,000 worth of out-of-court settlements. And so, there's about 41 million automobiles, and that'll cost $2.40. To fix the problem costs $8.59. So because it's cheaper to let people burn and die, that's what the company did. Now, if you do read the memo, which I'm sure you'll be able to find, it does say that in there that, the human cost of human life is immeasurable, et cetera, et cetera. But at the end of the day, GM decided to go down this road, is to let people burn and die. And that is, in essence, the capitalist mindset, is the pursuit of profit takes dominance over all things. So moving into part two is where we can look at, is production the problem? So, when you listen to the news, when you listen to, 680 News, they have a 4 minutes before the hour, they have a business report, and what dominates that are a bunch of statistics that come at you, like gross domestic product, so GDP's gone up, growth in the economy. Also, for example, has the stock market gone up? Or so these kind of measures are sort of kind of skewed. So why is that the case? Why are these measures most important? Right? And the reason is that because what determines the health of the economy in the capitalist system is growth. And so because then the reason why they believe it's growth is because it's the belief that man and human beings have infinite wants and infinite desires. So the theory is that we have to maximize production as much as possible so to fill that ocean of infinite needs and infinite wants. So, as I said, in terms of this production, we can see how this philosophy, how this impacts us. And so I was doing actually a different presentation, and I came across the leading causes of death, and I wanted to focus on two of them. Diabetes and heart disease. And you know, these things are real killers, and if you can think that 54,000 Canadians die a year from these diseases, right? So it's a serious problem in society, and one of the leading causes of that is sugar, right? And so one of the questions is, why do we have so much sugar in our food? And this, if you're young, and I think a lot of you guys are into health, well, you don't have to worry so much until you get old, but I suggest you start looking into this. There's a doctor by the name of Dr. Robert H. Lustig, and you can see this on YouTube, and he's done a video called Sugar, the Bitter Truth. And what he explains is to why there's so much sugar in our food. And what he explains is that what happened was that, you can see here on this part of the graph, the price of sugar going up and down. That's cane sugar. And so what the government did at that time in America is they said, okay, we have this problem, we don't have enough sugar, so let's produce more sugar. So how did they do that? So they subsidized the production of corn. And around that time, the Japanese had invented high fructose corn syrup. And so that's how sugar ended up in everything. And I'm just going to read you the quote from Dr. Lustig, when he says, high fructose corn syrup is evil. It's not evil because it's metabolically evil. It's evil because it's economically evil. It's cheap, so it ends up in everything. And in the video, you'll see what he talks. He received an email of someone who was going through the bread aisle, and one loaf of bread had no sugar. Every other loaf of bread was filled with sugar. One of the things, I don't know if you've seen, there was a recent episode of John Oliver where he talks about how even the science is being manipulated in terms of, and studies is being manipulated to still promote the production of sugar regardless of its health risks. And what they found is that when they looked at studies that were actually funded by sugar interests, like companies that produce sugar, etc., that those studies had a systematic bias. 83% of those studies found that there was no relationship between sugar and health problems. Those studies that had no financial conflict of interest, 83% of those studies found there actually was a problem. So you can see that the sugar industry is dedicated and even trying to manipulate the science to further their profit motive, right? So we're going to maximize the production of sugar regardless of what it does to our health. And that again, is part of the system, and that is what is making us sick and killing us. And for those of you who have seen the movie Food Inc., this is taken from there. One of the things that was kind of surprising and shocking is that they feed cows corn. Cows cannot digest corn. They can only digest grass. So that seems odd, right? It's like for us being forced to eat grass, right? Like we can't eat grass, so why would someone force you to eat something that you can't? So and one of the things that has emanates from that is that it actually makes the cows very sick. So like, you know, the stereotypical cow that you see in that sort of your picture in mind, like chewing the cud. That's called ruminating. And they cannot ruminate when they eat corn. So what happens is that they get a gas buildup in their stomach, and that's what they call something called a bloat. And you might see cows that have fallen over. And what ends up happening in their digestive tract is that it becomes a breeding ground for disease. So that's where E. coli 0157H7 gets produced in their gut, and this is what makes sick. So you've heard of mad cow disease and other health problems with meat. So you might ask yourself, why do they do this? Well, when you have a grass-fed cow, it takes 4.5 years for that cow to get to 1,200 pounds. When you have a corn-fed cow, it only takes 1.2 years to get there. So that's why they're making this meat which has problems in it. And it has real effects. In Food Inc., they show this child, Kevin. He ate three hamburgers and got E. coli and died in 12 days from this. So this method of production is a killer. It really does kill, right? So this concept that you know, that this economic system is intangible. It has real impacts and real problems. So again, the meat production is maximized regardless of its impact on our health. And going again, this is a quote from his mother. And what she says is, we put faith in our government to protect us, and we're not being protected at the most basic level. In a sense, what she's saying is, why do the meat producers lack this societal thinking? Why don't they think about who's eating the meat? Why is it just about maximizing that production? In terms of what we drink, does anyone know what this is? No environmentalists in the crowd? This is a, what do you call it? This is a tailings pond. A tailings pond is this is what a lot of the activists are angry about when it comes to the tar sands in Alberta. It's the toxic sludge that comes out of when they produce the bitumen oil. This is the toxic lakes that are produced. Naomi Klein, in her latest book, "And This Changes Everything," she talks about how you can see these things from space, these toxic giant toxic lagoons. And what ended up happening is that some ducks landed in it, and 600 of them had to be killed, right? So obviously it's a toxic substance. So can anyone foresee that this might be problematic? So what happened was that this is a Mount Polly mine, right? And so this up here is the tailings pond that emanates from that. So it's a copper and gold mine. And so this is the toxic sludge that's sitting there. And so they had a breach, and this is what it looks like after. So you can see like this retention basin, which was blue before. You can see the Polly Lake, which was blue, and that Casino Lake is blue. But now after, you can see that the pollution has gone into everywhere. And guess what? That's salmon country, right? So that is where fishermen make their livelihoods, mostly natives, who make their livelihoods from the salmon. So it's 14.5 cubic meters of toxic waste. Now, when I was putting this presentation together, I had a very difficult time trying to find out what was actually in that toxic stew, right? And so I had to watch a CBC clip about 5 times before I could capture, you know, this screenshot, right? And if you notice, like at the top, they kind of just focus on the copper and zinc, right? But what they don't focus on is the 84 tons of arsenic and 38 tons of lead that has ended up in this fresh water. You know, Canada is one of the few freshwater regions of the world. It has one of like the most fresh water. I don't know if it's like statistic. I think something like half of the world's fresh water is in Canada. And it's being contaminated by this production process, right? And so the question is that when you read there was an Australian lake, which I have on the slides there, which says this is the worst Canadian environmental disaster in modern history. And they said that, you know, the walls weren't big enough and all that. But the question is that does it really make sense to put this, to bring out all these toxic substances that end up in your water to drink, right? Or contaminate the food supply. So again, it's this concept of production. Anyone know what this is? Sorry? Any other thoughts? Any anti-globalization activists in the crowd?
Suicide net, right?
Yep, suicide net. This is the cost of an iPad. What happens is that maybe about a year ago in January, there was a big uproar over the working conditions of the factory workers in Foxconn. So Apple doesn't directly employ the people in China. They use a subcontractor as part of risk management. So basically, the working conditions are so horrendous that 14 people jumped off the roof and killed themselves, and about 4 attempted but didn't do that. The wage of a worker there is $283 or $300 a month, right? $300 a month. So to all of our fancy gadgets, including me, the Samsung or whatever, and I think it's unfair to single out Apple because all of them, are involved in this, and they all exploit the labor to this kind of thing, and just Apple got singled out for whatever reason. But this is the human cost of making an iPad, right? And just so you know, what they do is that's 60 hours a week. And that money, that $300, goes to actually just board and food. So it's like what happens is the people come from the rural area and they come and work in the factories and then they send the extra money back home, and so they make that extra money through overtime, right? So instead of raising the workers' wages, they put suicide nets on, right? So that way, you know, it's less splatter to clean up, right? I mean, this it sounds sick, but that's really what they're telling you, right? Like, it's not that we're going to pay the people more, right? It's that let's put up suicide nets. It's again, profits over people. This is the Rana Plaza tragedy, where in Bangladesh, 1,100 workers died, and 2,500 were injured. And there's an interesting thing on Guardian, the Guardian website, where they have an interactive a website. And if you watch the video, it tells you how much that a garment worker in Bangladesh will make. And in 11 minutes, a garment worker made less than a dollar Canadian. And the retailer that's selling those clothes made more than $1 million off that labor. So that's the stark sort of contrast. And at the time of the tragedy, the minimum wage for a Bengali worker was $37 a month. So if you're familiar with Walmart or Joe Fresh and all these companies, if you look at it, most of the clothes, especially Walmart, was made in Bangladesh, right? And so this is the sort of the human misery that goes into the making of clothes. 2014, what happened was they raised the minimum wage to $68 a month. But who had to eat that money? It was actually the Bengali factories that did, the Bengali companies who are subcontracted to do that had to eat it. Walmart or whoever the Western company, because the guy didn't want to reveal who the company was, said we're not going to eat it. You have to eat it. So the cost of the minimum wage is not going to be paid by Walmart or whoever the capitalist company who's in the West. It's not going to be paid out of them. It's going to be paid out of the companies in Bangladesh. You know, the question is this just and fair, right? And just to think about that, in a sense, is that how would we feel if we had to make clothes for Bangladeshis and Chinese at $68 a month, right? And like, if that was our thing, we had to work 80 hours a week in these factories that are, you know, that we might get crushed and killed to death in, and things like that, because your situation is so bad that you have to do that, right? Like, would you have positive emotions to people who put you in this kind of situation, right? So this again is that we have to get out of this kind of individual thing. Well, I got my clothes, I'm fine. I don't really care about where, you know, how the situation that those clothes are manufactured. But that's where you have to kind of emerge out of that and have to kind of think beyond just the individualist itself. In terms of, there's been a lot of coverage about Ebola. I just want to cover this quickly. It's basically what has happened is there's no vaccine made for Ebola, despite its health risk. And the reason for that, again, goes back to the profit motive, is that not enough people die or are affected a year for it to make sense to make the drug or any kind of treatment. And John Ashton, the UK Faculty of Public Health, he came out and just said that this is the moral bankruptcy of capitalism, right? Because there's not enough investment, not enough ROI means return on investment, that's a common lingo in capitalism. Because that's not there, there's no need to actually make any treatment. So this is sort of the way that the production system works. So if there's no profits, no money to be made, even if it's necessary for us as human beings, it won't be made. So just to summarize, production as a problem, it's poisoning our food, right? When we look at the sugar that we eat and consume, much stuff, much sugar, but the water, it's poisoning our water. We can see these toxic lakes are just a disaster waiting to happen. Did it really take the Mount Polly disaster for us to figure that out? I mean, you know that this arsenic is sitting in this large pool of basin. Gee, I wonder what's going to happen. It's socially destructive. I mean, this idea that does it really make sense? Is that do we really think it's that viable for the long term that the workers in the developing world are going to put up with these conditions? They didn't do that in America, because in America they had similar working conditions. They had sweatshops in America. Right? They had in the 1877, which was they had a first mass uprising. It was kind of like the Arab Spring, what happened in America, because they didn't want to work 80 hours a week, and so they rebelled against the companies. Right? In the 30s, they said that the Chicago corporations had more ammunition than the Chicago Police Department to put down the riots. right? So if America's aren't gonna put up with it, why do you think the people of China and Bangladesh are gonna put up with it, right? So like what I'm saying is that this is not a viable and long-term solution. And on the other hand, it doesn't meet our needs, right? We have health issues, we have health problems. You know, Ebola doesn't distinguish between the 99% and the 1%, right? It's gonna affect everybody, right? So it speaks to how it's making stuff we don't need, and it's causing us harm. And at the same time, it's not producing what we actually need. So what it makes us as human, our organic needs and who we are, the system is not meeting the goods. So moving on to part three, freedom and banking. So a good question would be, why were we talking about the financial crisis? It's like ancient history. It was like 7 years ago, you know, seven, 8 years ago. So why does it still matter? Well, actually, Timothy Lane, Deputy Governor of the Bank of Canada, says it still matters. He just delivered a speech in Carleton University just 2 months ago where he explained how the financial crisis is still a problem. And what he explained, and you can download this, is on the Bank of Canada's website. It says that the U.S. Federal Reserve's action of quantitative easing. Does everyone know what quantitative easing is? It's one of the things about capitalism is that you use these kind of terms like collateral damage. Collateral damage is like, well, you're killing innocent people, but you're gonna use a fancy term to hide the reality of what it is. What quantitative easing is that it's that the banks and the Fed, they printed money out of thin air and they bought the toxic assets from the banks, right? From Goldman Sachs and et cetera, et cetera. I'll get into the bailout a little bit later, but that's what quantitative easing. So when you read his speech, is that this is totally unconventional measures for the Federal Reserve to take, which shows you the dramatic nature of the problem. And what he says, the risk and vulnerability have increased in the financial system. And he goes on to say, but during this period, returning the United States to sustained economic growth has been of paramount importance. So again, so why did they do all this craziness of printing these trillions of dollars? Is to foster growth, because again, that's the capitalist problem. What will the exit mean for Canada? Meaning, when they stop doing these procedures, and that's a quote taken straight from the paper, says, is in the event that the Fed's renormalization does not play out smoothly in the financial markets, the impact on Canada could be significant. So what he's saying is that the crisis is not over, right? This what was unleashed with the bank disaster is still affecting us and has not been resolved. So let's go quickly over the financial, what exactly happened for those who aren't familiar. So basically, you see the rise in house prices. So it's going along from 1987 to 2000. That's just a moderate price rise, nothing dramatic. But all of a sudden, in 2000, there's a big uptick. You see 125% increase in 6.5 years. So what was fueling that? Well, banks were loaning money to subprime lenders. Subprime means that the person doesn't, you know, like when you see it, like bank ads, they have prime rates, and then they have rates that are higher than that, because what they were doing was, because the theory is that you should pay a higher interest rate on your loan because you are a higher risk. This is a higher risk of default, so you should pay more. So if you're poor, you should pay more. If you're rich, you should pay less, right? So that makes a lot of sense. So basically, they loaned these guys money. And then the mortgages went on the books. So this is like a normal transaction, so I can say there's nothing to think about this. But this is where the funky part starts. So what happens is that these mortgages were put into these pools, and they were called securitized. They were like put into these pools. And then what was happened was bonds were issued against those pools. So those mortgages did not stay on the books of those banks. So the ones that issued the mortgage, they didn't have to keep any risk of it. They just kind of send it off to these institutions. And sort of where the whole linchpin in this is that they were rated AAA. So these bond rating companies like Fitch and Moody's and Standard & Poor's, where they put a AAA rating on this subprime thing. So what they're saying is that this is a risk-free bond. This is good as buying a T-bill from the American government. That's what they were telling the people. And so we sort of know how that kind of pans out. So this giant pool of money is what fueled that bubble. Because what was happening at that time, because if you remember that spike started in 2000, anyone know what was the big problem in 2000? Anton, remember? Yeah, dot-com bubble. Any other? That's probably the most important one. But what's what else was going on there? Enron, right? Enron, WorldCom, you know, these kind of things. These sort of kind of financial disasters happening. So the Fed put the rate to zero, right? So that means that the interest, if you want, for the companies that wanted to make money off interest, there wasn't much going on. But then there was bonds that were going on, right? So now these bonds were offering higher rates of interest, right? So that's why that Wall Street went wild in terms of, you know, finding these mortgages packaging it, and that's why you see that sudden huge bubble, right? So then the real estate bubble popped. Because you see, what's implicit in all of this, right, is that if the housing prices are going up, what happens to the people that can't pay? You kick them out and you sell the house, right? Because if the prices are going up, so like the fact that the person can't pay, it's not a big deal, right? Because you just throw them out on the street, and then you just you sell the house, right? And so your ROI is good. So like you're maximizing your freedom of ownership, right? But then when the real estate prices started going down, that's when the house of cards started coming apart. And so what happened was, yeah, the real estate market bubble burst. Fund institutions had these worthless bonds. Remember that AAA rating? It wasn't really AAA after all, right? So what happened was that now the problem was is that, if you remember this picture here, is that these bonds, right, which they bought like cartloads of them because they wanted to make money, right, is sitting on their balance sheets, right? When you go to borrow, people look at your balance sheet, right? So all of a sudden, no one can trust anyone's balance sheet, right? They look at you, you don't have $10 million. You have nothing. You have this toxic sludge. I know you have toxic sludge because I bought the same crap, right? So what happened was that stopped extending credit. So companies stopped extending credit, and that's when you had the credit crunch, right? People couldn't borrow money because all of a sudden everyone freaked out. All the lending institutions freaked out. And so then you don't have credit, so people can't buy. It's a debt-based economy, right? Then companies go bankrupt, and there's job losses, and then you had this downward spiral, right? Because you had this inflated economy that was built on a house of cards coming crashing down. And so what they ended up doing is they printed, they had a bailout of $15 trillion, right? That's how massive the problem was. Just conjuring $15 trillion and just shoving it into the economy, right? So you had, like institutions here, like you can see, like someone got Citibank got $411 billion in a bailout. The interesting one that you should pay attention to is AIG. AIG, it still owes $181 billion. And what AIG was doing, they were actually insuring the bonds, right? They would put insurance on them because it was AAA. So they just insured it, so meaning that if the value went down, they were on the hook for that, right? And what ended up happening was the government sort of funneled all the money like to Goldman and Sachs and these other companies through AIG, right? That's basically what happened was that insurance, they were kept topping up AIG, I was just paying out the bank. So it's kind of a way to kind of mask how the bailout was sort of funneled to these giant companies, and that's where so they were rewarded for fraudulent practices. Essentially, they had these AAA ratings. In one of the books I was going through, it said that it went from a AAA. It was actually a B rating, which is 16 downgrades. Right. So it's a difference of 16. That's what I believe it was Matt Taibbi. He's written a series in Rolling Stones. It's called, and he refers to Goldman Sachs as a giant vampire squid that sticks its blood funnel into any kind of money vessel as possible. And I believe it was him who was coming up with that. In a sense, it's like selling a car without an engine, right? If someone sold you a car without an engine, that's fraud, right? And basically that's what was behind this sort of big scheme was fraud. Because when they went through Fitch's sort of like audit papers, if you will, there was nothing there. No one looked at anything, right? No one looked at the how good the loans were and that type of thing. They just slapped a AAA rating on it. So the aftermath is what we see is that the banks broke the world economy. And as they say, if you break it, you should buy it. But they just got bailed out instead, right? So they won the lottery. because they're the 1%. And you know, I mean, if you like made stupid decision or I made stupid decisions financially, is are we going to get $411 billion, right, for our decision? And I think there's one thing that sort of is hidden and not really discussed in the whole crisis, right, is that there's inevitably always going to be a payment crisis in a debt, in an interest-based economy, because the interest is not based on reality. It's just an artificial number that someone just tacks onto a loan. It's not linked to the actual economic activity. The Babylonians, when they used to practice interest, they used to have a system when the new king ascended the throne, all the debts were wiped out, because they understood this concept that there's that interest is not sustainable, that you can't grow it. It's a geometric sequence that just grows like a virus, right? That's the only thing that grows like that. And a virus, when it grows like that, it'll kill its host, right? And this is something that not a lot of people really want to talk about, because what then you're implying is that interest should not be legal, right? And that is the real problem. And I think that the other thing is that what it really illustrates is how you can't do what you want, right? That when one sector of society and another sector of society, we all are affected by each other. So the banks thought that just by, you know, giving these poor people these loans and this idea, you can just throw them out of the house if they can't pay, and that everyone will be okay. It didn't work out. Like, I mean, there was a bank in Dusseldorf, Germany, that went up in smoke because of this, right? Just $32 billion just wiped out. Iceland wiped out, right? The Germans had this idea that, you know, that when someone says a AAA, it's AAA. So they had that belief that they trusted the Americans, right? And they were quite livid when this whole kind of financial catastrophe happened, right? So it shows you that this idea, this individualism, that, you know, people can do what they want and somehow it works out, it contradicts reality. And going back to the Deputy Governor of Bank of Canada, he says, the financial crisis of 2008 reminds us how tightly linked the U.S. and Canadian economies are, for better or for worse. And so what he's saying is that, you know, he's even making the point that whatever happens in the U.S. will affect us, right? And so this idea of interconnectedness is much more implied in the reality. So I just want to highlight the role of the capitalist belief in the crisis. When they were looking to deregulate the banks, it started in 1997. This is actually Eugene Ludwig. He's the Clinton's guy, so he's a Democrat. And when he says, we must not place any unneeded restrictions on the banks. And Senator Phil Graham spelled this out a little bit more. And what he said was that here we are today to repeal Glass-Steagall. Because we have learned that government is not the answer. We have learned that freedom and competition are the answers. So what is Glass-Steagall? Glass-Steagall was the act put in 1933 after the Great Depression to do what? To stop the banks from doing what they just did, right? That was the whole point of Glass-Steagall. See, what happened was that the banks, Glass-Steagall separated the deposit institutions like that would serve the society, like, you know, people who just want to do checking and just house, like normal retail stuff. And then you had the investment banks, sort of the Goldman Sachs, which deal with the corporations. Right? And so they wanted to keep them separate. So these guys make bad bets, it doesn't affect the real economy, right? That was the point. But you see, the reasons why the Goldman Sachs want to merge with those guys is then you can use this thing called leverage, right? Is that once you have the assets from the retail banks, you can bet more. And Naomi Prince was saying that leverage is around 40. So for every $1 of real assets they have, they borrowed $40 against that. So they combine these two institutions, which they weren't supposed to, and then they bet everything on it, 40 times over. So in terms of how vulnerable are we, when you look at the current economic situation, given this overhang of the financial crisis, how bad are things? Youth unemployment in Ontario is between 16 and 17% in the 15 to 24-year-old category. And so this kind of talks to you about statistics, because the monthly youth unemployment rate is 50%. That means only 50% in this category have jobs. The other 50% don't. But for statistical and other reasons, they're not included in the unemployment rate. In America, things are a little bit better, but not by much. Sorry, I should say America there. It's 14.3%, and that's for the unemployment rate for 16 to 24 years old. And it shows you that how bad things are actually in Ontario, because in this category, 65% are actually employed and participate in the economy and do that. And obviously, this unemployment was a big cause of the Occupy. Student debt, U.S. student debt has quadrupled to $1.1 trillion, and the average debt load in Canada is $27,000. And I was reading, actually, I was in the Hamilton has an art crawl downtown, and I was getting some coffee, and then I read this incident in this newspaper, it's like a free newspaper. And Aridisi said that Ontario youth are actually prostituting themselves to pay for their education, right? So the thing is that you have to ask yourself, what kind of society would put your youth who are trying to get an education to get by, to make that kind of choice, right? It doesn't, regardless of what you think of prostitution, the point is that, like, why would a society enable and think that someone who has to think about their future has to go through that kind of decision, right? And they document about three or four people who have decided to make that choice to do that. The Conservative government recently leaked a report which has said that the Canadian dream is a myth more than the reality, right? And so what they're talking about is that the idea that you're going to go from middle class to you're going to go from the 99% to the 1% is a joke. Like, it's not happening, right? And none of the other parties kind of disagree with that. And so they go through a bunch of things, but one of the key things is that they said the debt to income ratio is 163%. That's how leveraged people are. That's how people are, the middle incomes are, people are making their, meet their shortfall. And it also details how there's been that the wages of the middle income category has been stagnant. It's just grown 1.7% over 15 years, right? But things are great for the 1%. The top 246,000 took 30% of all the growth in incomes from 1997 to 2007. This is from the Canadian Center for Policy Alternatives. And just to give you an idea of what that really means, just kind of put it in picture, because sometimes when you look at numbers, it's kind of like, okay, what does that really mean, right? So, this is, Saskatoon is somewhere here. I don't know where it is in Saskatchewan, but I've got the picture there. Saskatchewan has about 260,000 people, and they're getting that chunk, right? And then 68% of the people, is this, the whole other country is sharing that at 68%. So that whole Canada is sharing that orange slice, while Saskatoon, which you can't even see on this map, is sharing that 32% of that, right? That's the nature of the economy. So what does this tell us? It says that, you know, the system's not really working. Like, it's skewed in the favor of the 1%, and the financial system favors capital, hence capitalism, right? In terms of capitalism, what's the crisis going on? The real crisis is a belief. Remember what I told you at the start, is that capitalism is a belief that was emanated from this struggle between the church and state, the church and the intellectuals, and this came to this concept of freedom, right? Now people are starting to say, well, they're starting to question that. The Occupy protesters, which was brutally repressed, which was not covered, which speaks a lot to the corporate media, that 8,000 arrests happened, right? So you're used to seeing the third world dictators, club the people when they protest. In Bangladesh, for example, they shoot people when they want to collect their wages. But you didn't necessarily see that being covered in the media. They just kind of tried to show the Occupy people as clueless, just to paint them that way. And there was a massive surveillance effort to spy on those groups, which really speaks to this concept of being able to voice your discontent. This is what happens when you voice your discontent. But I think that one of the most important things is how Alan Greenspan, how he discovered that he had a flaw in his ideology. And you have to understand who Alan Greenspan was. He was a Federal Reserve Chairman from 1987 to 2006, and he basically said that he used to say some words and then all the stock market would go down in price because he thought they were going to jack up the interest rates. And what he said in the aftermath of this crisis is, yes, I found a flaw in my ideology, meaning that capitalism is not working out. And more surprising than that, he actually called for the nationalization of some banks. He's the disciple of Ayn Rand. Ayn Rand is an atheist capitalist who said that selfishness is good, greed is good. You know, selfishness is a virtue, greed is good. And he's saying you should nationalize the bank. He's taking a page out of communism and he's saying that. So this is how affected he was by the crisis, meaning that even someone like Greenspan is questioning capitalism. Thomas Piketty, this book is published by the communist Harvard Press, of course, he's saying that basically the, on, the, on the current trend, the way that capitalism is going to go is going to go back to an aristocratic era where you become wealthy because you're born to wealth. You could be the best scientist or whatever in the world, but it doesn't matter. If you're not in that elite club, you're not going to make it. So what's the real problem? It's like we can do whatever we want, everything will be okay, system's making us sick, and it's not delivering on the goods in terms of taking us to the future. So to the concluding point, disaster capitalism, or is capitalism a disaster? Can anyone guess where these headlines are from? How many people think it'd be from the financial crisis? It says your banking issues need more attention, bailout of banks still need to on track, new wage to bad loans. Sounds like it comes from the financial crisis, right? Actually, it comes from 1988, right? So you can see, we just went through this financial crisis. There was actually a repeat of what happened in 1988. At that time, Reagan had deregulated the savings and loan industry, right? And he said the same thing as you saw the other politicians say, is it's only a first step in financial deregulation. And then what happened was 50% of the savings and loans companies went bankrupt. It cost the taxpayers $519 billion, but it's because they were linked to real estate, right? So what you saw just happened in 2007, 2008, it happened before 1988. And what it really highlights is that there is no such thing as disaster capitalism, because what disaster capitalism maintains is that there's sort of a good capitalism. There's a bad capitalism, there's a good capitalism, because that's what's implied in the title. And I don't know if Naomi Klein has changed her mind about this based on her recent book, where she really questions a lot of the fundamentals of capitalism. But what it really speaks to is that if you believe you're free, then you'll always hate regulation. That you can't, if you are believe in freedom and I can do what I want, then you're not going to agree to regulations. And this is exactly what happened, right? Is that it doesn't matter that the savings and loan things happened in 1988. All these senators were probably alive when that happened, when they repealed Glass-Steagall, right? Because things were good. So freedom is the answer, to quote Phil Grant. So production is, in conclusion, like the focus on production is incorrect. It's destroying our ecological system. It doesn't focus on what we need. And money's not an industry. The idea that you can just make money from money is an idea that's actually destroying the economy, not assisting it. And we will be talking about more about this. So in terms of what do we do now, right? It's, because normally you go to a lecture, you listen to it, and kind of get distracted, right? You know, there's sports, there's TV and stuff like that, right? But I'm not trying to say anything bad about anyone. And actually, what I want to highlight is, why is it this way? Why do we get distracted? Because I have the same problems, right? You see something on Yahoo News, you click it, you know, this one did that guy did that, right? So it's actually quite sinister, because the way capitalism works is that, and this is Harold Laswell, he's one of the architects of the system, who is a political science professor, and he was part of this these sort of thinkers that design the current system we live in. And what he talks about is that, before capitalism, there was this idea of monarchy and class, and that's what held the society together. And he says, what is now, we have the ideology of individual, which passes for the official religion. So if you go back here, like, this is the ideology of the individual, just focusing on yourself, just about having fun, and these types of things. And he says, the new antidote to this kind of individualism is willful propaganda, right? If the masses will not be free of chains of iron, they must accept chains of silver. If it will not love, honor, and obey, it must not expect to escape seduction. Right. So what it's saying is that the media system is designed to distract us, right, and just to worry about useless things. And there's other thinkers like Aldous Huxley, and also there's another book, I'm Using Us to Death. These books talk about the effects of this mass media, sensation media, which is designed to do that. And so we have to work hard to kind of fight this temptation, just to give into these into the chains of silver, if you will, and instead be active. So I hope that you will come next week, where we'll be talking about how do you move from individualism to societal thinking. If production is not the problem, what is? And how can you create an equitable financial system that engenders entrepreneurship without capitalism? So I hope we can continue the conversation, and I will be happy to continue.